Well, I know this is the Christmas season, and so we will wrap this message this week and next week around the Christmas season as well. So please don't be offended at the way it begins. Please don't say, oh, gee, because we're going to continue on with our The Gods Must Be Crazy series. I'd like for you to turn with me to begin with to a passage probably that your Bible will fall open to by now. That's in Isaiah chapter 40. And there are three specific verses in the book of Isaiah here, pertaining to this, that really began my journey nearly 40 years ago, verses that I stumbled upon as a result of having read the reference from Matthew chapter 13, who do men say that I am, but who do you say that I am? Having been cross-referenced, I guess you could say, in the scriptures back to Isaiah chapter 40, I began there, and it began our journey, or began to give us impetus for our journey. So if you'll just go with me quickly to Isaiah 40, verse 18, we're just going to read 18, 19, and 20. To whom then will you liken God? Or what likeness will you compare to him? The workman molds an image. The goldsmith overspreads it with gold. The silversmith casts silver chains. Whoever is too impoverished for such a contribution chooses a tree that will not rot. He seeks for himself a skillful workman to prepare a carved image that will not totter. If you'll just drop down to verse 25, to whom then will you liken me? Or to whom shall I be equal, says the Holy One? And then over to chapter 46 and verses 5 through 7. To whom will you liken me and make me equal and compare me that we should be alike? They lavish gold out of the bag and weigh silver on the scales. They hire a goldsmith and he makes it a god. They prostrate themselves. Yes, they worship. They bear it on their shoulder. They carry it. They set it in its place and it stands. From its place it shall not move. Though one cries out to it, yet it cannot answer nor save him out of his trouble. And as we have said, here we have, for all time, not just for times of antiquity, not just for Israel in that particular moment, but here we have for all time the question that demands an answer or that begs an answer in every man's heart. To whom then will you liken God? He spoke it in the first person a couple of times there. To whom then will you liken me? But this is the question that begs an answer and receives an answer, actually, from every man's heart throughout all of time, right? Now, we have seen that Israel's answer was formulated from polytheism. Israel's answer, and this is what's being addressed here, actually, in the book of Isaiah, but Israel's answer was one that had been formulated from polytheism. It was a blending together of all of the gods of their nations, of the nations that were both their enemies, and their neighbors. But it was an ascribing, as we've said, an ascribing to Elohim's identity, the attributes of all of the many gods that they encountered in their travels, in being conquered and in their conquests. So it was an ascribing to Elohim's identity, a likening, a comparison, an equality of all of these other gods. And so this is whom Elohim became. So their answer was some revelation of this polytheistic society and culture that they had fostered, having come out of Egypt, being warned about, their involvement with other gods. And as we've seen, 318 times the word gods plural or idols plural is used throughout the Old Testament, indicating to us that this was an issue with all of Israel's history, not to just some specific moment in their time, but throughout their history as they left in Exodus, and as we see it going clear on through the Old Testament. But the result of their polytheism, we saw, was maybe summarized for us in the words of the writer, the author of 2 Chronicles, when he called it what? The ruin of all Israel. The ruin of all Israel. And again, where that was a specific moment referring to King Ahaz and his ruin and so on and so forth, that we've seen, I believe, in the scripture that this ruin of all Israel continued to manifest itself down through the years, both before and after Ahaz, right? So now, certainly, as Christians, as fundamentalist, evangelical, whatever, that we would be quick to berate, Israel's idolatry and their foolishness, their polytheistic thing. But I would like you to remember that the purpose of this particular series has been to demonstrate to you and I that Christianity today is every bit as polytheistic in their message as Israel was then. And hopefully you've recognized that as we've talked about this. I mean, I've said to you 2 weeks in a row, and I'm going to say it one more time because I want you to get this. Everybody say every. Every message that you've ever heard on what you must do in order to be, fill in the blank. Every message that you have ever heard, you see, about the apocalyptic judgment of God, eternal conscious torment, you know, authoritarian domination systems, hierarchical systems. Every message that you've ever heard suggesting distance, separation, you know, that type of thing. Every one of those is a revelation of polytheistic doctrine in the church. I want you to get that right now. So I'm repeating it because I really want us to understand how inundated we have become with a polytheistic message. It's what we share with the world. It's what we defend. It's what we take issue with one another. We fight over, we argue over polytheistic points of view. Isn't that right? All right, now, you know, of course, our brand of idolatry isn't as out there, you know, is you know, so far out there as to celebrate the deity of Zeus and Jupiter and Odin and maybe more biblical with regard to our Old Testament context, you know, Ashtaroth and Baal and Molech and Mars. Or is it? Or is our polytheism still is out there to where we well, we'll talk about that more as we go, I guess. Say, we've already mentioned Molech and how we have celebrated Molech in our doctrine. Isn't that right? And we certainly celebrate Mars. Isn't that right? The god of war. I want to make sure you understand who I'm talking about. Okay? But nevertheless, you know, without discerning Israel's product, in other words, without discerning the god that Israel assimilated out of their interaction with other gods, Without discerning the God that they put together for us, see, you know, we've stumbled blindly on accepting and promoting their cumulative God. Isn't that right? Their cumulative God. You know, and the character sketches that they provided for us, we've gone ahead and we've promoted these as infallible and inerrant revelations of the truth of God. Isn't that right? Think about this. Think about it. We have expounded it from pulpits and in Bible schools. We have explained it. We have defended it. Isn't that right? Now listen, as I said to you, I believe last week, you know, two of the most common names in grace faith teaching have extensive teachings, explanations for why God had to be the way he was in the Old Testament, for why he had to do the horrible things that he did in the Old Testament. They have, this is part of their grace message. See? And again, I'm not picking on these guys. I'm not picking on these women. I'm not picking on these people. I just want us to understand that polytheism has perforated and impregnated the message of Christianity in our day. And it's been this way for quite some time. So we need to be recognizing this in order to be extricated from it. So we have to start somewhere, isn't that right?
That's right.
All right, so but anyway, we've expounded this message. And we've taught it to our children in Sunday schools and in daily vacation Bible schools. This will be a strange word to some of you younger people. We have flannel graphed this God's exploits before our children in order to emblazon upon their hearts how they must live in order to be. Yeah. That right?
That's right?
I mean, I'll tell you what. Now, my mother was pretty good about just flannel graphing. She did good news clubs and brought all the children from the neighborhood in when I was a boy and made me deliver. That was my first step in evangelism, made me deliver the invitations. Would you like to come and hear about Jesus at my house? It was easier in the 50s. More people said okay back then than they would now. But anyway, yeah, but I remember those flannel graphs, you know. I remember those pictures of the ark. I remember those pictures of Lot and his poor, destined to be table salt wife, you know, fleeing from Gomorrah, Sodom and Gomorrah, right? I remember those things. Oh my gosh. So as I said, that's why I came up with that thought yesterday. We have flannel graphed these things into our children's hearts or into your hearts. Our children probably won't get any more flannel graft, you know, but anyway, but we've done that. But now looking at these verses, look, we're in chapter 46. So let me read just 6 and 7 to you again out of this chapter 46. They lavish gold out of the bag. They weigh silver on the scales. They hire a goldsmith and he makes it a god. They prostrate themselves. Yes, they worship. They bear it on their shoulders. They carry it. And set it in its place, and it stands. From its place it shall not move. Though one cries out to it, yet it cannot answer nor save him out of his trouble. And if you'll just back over into chapter 40 real quick and just read the 19th and 20th verse again with me. The workman molds an image. The goldsmith overspreads it with gold. The silversmith casts silver chains. Whoever is too impoverished for such a contribution chooses a tree that will not rot. He seeks for himself a skillful workman to prepare a carved image that will not totter. Now, here's what I want you to see here. We're being confronted here in these four verses that I've just read with an issue of mankind's accountability. And that is this. Listen, the gods of the nations were the product of humanity. What came first, the chicken or the egg? See, what came first, the gods of the nations or the people's polytheistic worship of the gods of the nations? What we're seeing here is that mankind is held accountable in a sense here for having created the gods of the nations. Isn't that right? Now, lest we should exclude Israel from the nations, go with me just quickly back to Exodus chapter 32. And let's make sure that when we use the word the gods of the nations, we're not excluding poor Israel. Verse 1, Exodus 32. When the people saw that Moses delayed coming down from the mountain, the people gathered together to Aaron and said to him, "Come, make us gods that shall go before us." For as for this Moses, the man who brought us up out of the land of Egypt, we do not know what has become of him. And Aaron said to them, "Break off the golden earrings which are in the ears of your wives, your sons, and your daughters, and bring them to me." So all the people broke off the golden earrings which were in their ears and brought them to Aaron. And he received the gold from their hand, and he fashioned it with an engraving tool and made a molded calf. Then they said, "This is your God, O Israel." I told you before, the literal here says, "These are your gods." Okay, but it says, "This is your God, O Israel, that brought you out of the land of Egypt." So you see, in Isaiah, we're finding the same thing that we see right here. We're just seeing humanity called to account for the fact that these gods were actually a creation of their own heart, right? These are the gods that Paul referred to in 2 Corinthians 4:8 and said to us that you served by nature, didn't say to us, said to them, but I mean, it would apply to us as well. You served or became enslaved to those who by nature were not gods or are not gods. Paul said some other things that we've looked at. He said that they were shaped by art and man's devising over in Acts chapter 14. Shaped by art and man's devising. The word devising there means thoughts and imaginations. Right? He went on to say that they were the fabrication, Romans chapter 1, of futile thoughts and darkened hearts. He went on to say in Romans chapter 1 that they were images made like corruptible man. See what I'm saying? So here's the thing. The gods were merely the reflections of the men who had made them. Isn't that right? Okay. Now this is where I want you to hear me carefully, because we're going to move this on into its present day application. You might say it this way. The gods of antiquity were the scapegoats of human depravity and desire. What's a scapegoat? One who is made to take the blame for another. The gods of antiquity were the scapegoats of human depravity and desire. In other words, the justification and the continuation of human desire was the impetus or the motivation for the design and the commissioning of these gods. Hear what I'm saying? And each one of these gods was given a particular name and an appropriate mythology in order to prepare them to serve as humanity's scapegoats. There had to be a mythology connected to it. And so each god was given a name. Excuse me. Was given a name. And a couple of days ago when I coughed, she would have responded. But she's gotten, or she's not responding now, see? We're not doing it in stereo anymore. It's down to just me. That's right. That's right. But as I said, I want you to get this, you know, that each god was given a name and was assigned by man, you know, an appropriate mythology in order that they might serve as scapegoats for human desire. That make sense to you? Okay. But now I'm talking about antiquity. But enough about antiquity, because obviously we're just using this to go somewhere else. Here's what I need to ask you. Can you see how the character sketches of Israel continue to serve our purposes today in matters such as conditional forgiveness, matters that suggest separation, distance, exclusion? Can you see how the character sketches, the personality sketches of Israel's God continue to serve us today in matters of violence, in matters of retribution, in matters of sacrificial requirement? Requirement being the key word right there, okay? See, attributing these attributes to Abba, to the Father, you know, is rooted in one thing. It's rooted in our desire for self-justification in the ongoing attitudes and behaviors of our lives. Let me say that again, because the next thing I'm about to say, I want to make sure you get. Attributing these attributes, or ascribing these attributes, conditional forgiveness, eternal conscious torment, you know, authoritarian dominion systems, hierarchical systems, sacrificial requirement in order to be right, right? All of these things. Attributing these attributes is really rooted in our desire for self-justification in the ongoing attitudes and behaviors of our lives. Or in other words, and this is what I want you to hear, we have become a Christianity that is scapegoating our God. We're scapegoating our own God, isn't that right? That's right. And really, this goes a long way towards explaining the resistance that we receive from the many Christians who stand in opposition to this Reformation message. Because you see, to think better of God requires something better of me, and I have issues with, fill in the blank, right? Because you see, if my God doesn't have issues with fill in the blank, then I cannot be justified in having issues with fill in the blank, can I? See what I'm saying? And so this is the way this has developed in the church today too. It has come over from, as we have embraced the flannel graft vision version of Israel's God, okay, this cumulative God. See, as we have embraced this, what's happened is we have begun, without realizing it, to be scapegoating our God. Wow. So while we rightly say, as I've said several times, while we rightly say the God you believe in is the God you will serve, or the God you will reflect, I mean, the God you believe in is the God you will reflect. While we rightly say that, we must first understand, though, that the very, the very breath of these imposter gods was given them by humanity. We breathed into their nostrils the breath of life, and these gods became living entities, either with names and mythologies before, or now with just attitudes and practices that we condone and feel justified in. You get anything out of this? See what I'm saying? All right. Now, again, in fairness, to the humanity of antiquity, and I want to be fair to them, okay? That they're back there, we're up here, we have a better, you know, we can look back on things and we can make judgments that that they were not capable of making at the time. So in fairness to them, you know, polytheism was their attempt to make sense of the world of good and evil around them and to explain their own passions in response to the good and evil around them. And somewhere back in the depths of their memory, there was a something that came up that told them that there was a God that was originally behind the order and the arrangement of the cosmos. They had that vague memory. And so naturally, as I said to you last week, I think it was, these gods played a role in the developing story. See? So in other words, so on the one hand, we're saying that man gave life to these gods, no question about it. See? Man breathed life into these into his imaginations, and they became so real that they deserved a name and maybe a place of residence, you know, Mount Olympus or somewhere, you know. They had a place of residence to go along with their name, and it was part of their mythology, see? And from their place of residence, their attributes rained down upon man one way or another, see? And so this was part of their explaining and dealing with the world of good and evil that was now around them and the response of their own passions as a result of these things, see? So it's kind of a two-headed coin almost here, but anyway, so but their explanations, Paul tells us, came from what? From futile thoughts and darkened hearts. But we want to be fair to them. We want to realize that they were trying to deal with something that, as we saw in Paul's explanation over in Romans chapter 1, had become, you know, they were no longer magnifying God as God. They no longer retain the knowledge, God in their knowledge. They exchanged the truth of God for the lie. See, all of those things had happened progressively. And so now what we have is just a vague remembrance. Like you might remember a grandparent that passed away when you were 2 or 3. You just had enough awareness of them that you kind of remember that you had a grandparent. Not somebody that you got involved with or, you know, or intimate with, but just somebody that, yes, I remember grandma or I remember grandpa or whatever, see? And that's what they had. They had a vague remembrance that said, God is behind all of this. See, when there is war, when there is hatred, when there is violence, when there is retribution, when there is unforgiveness, when there is this one and there is that, God is behind that. What shall his name be? Well, we shall name him Baal. We shall call his name Baal. We shall call his name Mars, for he has brought war to his people rather than peace on earth, goodwill towards men. I'm going to preach 6 more weeks on what Nathan said in 5 minutes up here this morning. You notice I'm hanging on. I'm not giving in and going home and saying amen like my wife suggested we could do. All right. So, how can, you know, humanity escape the futility of their mind, of their thoughts? How can humanity's darkened hearts become enlightened? One way and one way only, the Logos must become flesh. What have we learned about Logos? Logos is the way reality is structured, right? The way reality is structured. What is reality? Truth. The way truth is structured. So the Logos, the way reality is structured, must become flesh. And so when John tells us the Word became flesh and dwelt among us full of grace and truth, what we're to understand from that is that this flesh that he is referencing here in John chapter 1, verse 14, this flesh is the way reality or truth is structured. Right? Or ordered and arranged. Specifically pertaining to what? I should say to whom? To the Father. What is the problem in the world when the Word becomes flesh? Sickness and disease? No. Sin? No. Poverty? No. Those are not the problems in the world. When the word is made flesh in this polytheistic culture, which was not just Israel's culture, but the culture of the whole world around them, when the word became flesh, the problem was the revelation of Abba. Is that right? These other gods had absconded with his good reputation and had left him, see, with this criminal reputation, with this horrific reputation, right? And so when we talk about the Logos, the way reality is structured, becoming flesh, what we're being told is that Jesus is not the testimony of, but is the way the reality of God is structured, the truth of God. He is the structure of the living God. Isn't that right? We need to get that. Pertaining, as I said, didn't he say, what did he say? I am the truth. That's what he said. He said, I am the way reality is structured. I am the truth. And as I said, pertaining primarily to, certainly all these other things fall in line behind it, but get in line, take a number, because the most important thing, the head of the line, is the revelation of Abba. That's the thing that matters. Okay? Go with me to John 6:46 again. Need to go on and read Caleb's post from this morning on Imperfect Pastor. Very good. And remember, the imperfect pastor is him, not me. I just want to make sure you got that. Yeah. Is it? What? What'd you say? He's your son. I know I heard what she said. You don't have to repeat it. My gosh, what a cooperative spirit of unity we have in this church. Yeah. John 6:46, we were here. Not that anyone has seen, what's that word mean? Rightly perceived. I'm just making it very simple, but rightly perceived. And if you can't rightly perceive, what can you also not do? Rightly report or record, right? Okay. Not that anyone, or we're just going to say not anyone, has seen or rightly perceived the Father except he who is from God. The word from there is better off as of God. From God is like me sending a messenger somewhere. Of God means he's of me, right? Okay. And then go back to John 1:18. Again, I know you know these, but we've got to put this in the context of what we're talking about now. John 1:18, many times we've been here. No one, everybody say no one.
No one.
Has rightly perceived God at any time. Say at any time. All right, as I've said over and over and over till you're tired of hearing me say it. That means Moses, that means Isaiah, that means Jeremiah, that means John the Baptist, that means all of those people that are our heroes of inerrancy and infallibility in the Old Testament. Yeah. Right? Godly people seeking to know God, desiring to know God, but confused by the polytheistic involvement that they had. Not bad people, not people to be scorned, not people to be put down, not people that would justify us throwing away the Old Testament. But as I've said over and over, these are people who justify us learning to read the Old Testament for what it's supposed to mean to us today, not for what it's not supposed to mean. Extracting the validity, rejecting the invalid, right? Taking the relevancy, getting rid of the irrelevancy, okay? All right. So we know that one again. Again, no one has seen God at any time. The only begotten Son who is in the bosom of the Father, he has declared him. Now go with me back over to Matthew chapter 11. Verse 27. We're going to read 27 and 28 together. And actually, all of this should be together. But we're just going to work on 27 and 28 for just a moment here. But because I'm going to say 28 belongs with 27, but so does 29 and 30. So, but all things have been delivered to me by my Father. And no one knows the Son except the Father. The word knows means rightly understands. No one rightly or accurately understands the Son except the Father, nor does anyone rightly understand or perceive the Father except the Son, and the one to whom the Son wills to reveal him. Come to me, all you who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. I wanted to read it like this. And in fact, I wrote the word so in there in between verse 27 and 28. Nor does anyone know the Father except the Son and the one to whom the Son wills to reveal him. So come to me, all you who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. First of all, he says, all things have been given to me. And if we don't look at this correctly, this is a very ambiguous things. All right? All things. All right? But notice as you go through the next two verses that there is a personification applied to things. Because what does it say? It says one, anyone, whom, all, and you. Those are the words that occur in the next part of those two verses. So in other words, there is a personification of things. You hear what I'm saying? See, this word things can be very ambiguous. It can be very troublesome. You know, Caleb pointed it out when he was teaching out of 2 Corinthians 5:16. You know, all things have become new, right? Well, that whole context there is about God and man, not about God and stuff, yeah. Right? So things can be ambiguous, and we need to understand to read it in the context of what's being discussed here, right? So things is okay if it first of all understands the inclusion, if it first of all understands the inclusion of one, anyone, whom, all, and you, and then envelops the cosmos with that understanding. But when things is understood, or is understood to mean, you know, things into which man can include himself by his appropriate activities, then things is read wrong. See what I said? And see, that's the way we have been inclined to read things, because we've been taught to read things that way. Where did we learn to read things like that? Well, from our polytheistic doctrines. Because that's what the other gods want you to believe, the gods of your mind. That for you and I as Christians, almost exclusively came from Israel's character sketches. We didn't learn about God on the streets of Fort Collins or the streets of the town we grew up in. We learned about God in our churches, in our homes, primarily from the Old Testament. Because Sunday school just seems to do so much better with children's stories out of the Old Testament. Doesn't it? Now, we're not letting all the writers of the New Testament off the hook, but we got to deal with where all this stuff started. We see some attachments to the old way of thinking in Peter, in John, in Paul, and I mean all of them. Why would we expect anything less? I mean, I'm 40 years removed from some of the evangelical teachings that I was raised in, and I still am discovering the influence of some of those things on my life today. See what I'm saying? So why would we expect Paul and these guys who have just come out of a very, you know, intense relationship with polytheism to have a clear mind on all matters? Right? But we're going to stick with what we got going here right now. And again, remember what I'm doing, what my intention, I think I said this in week one, is not that we would learn to distrust the Bible, but that we would learn to appreciate its message even more. These things that I'm talking to you about, most of these are things that have been alive in me, maybe just germinating, but some of them have become big things for the last 15, 20 years. Some of them are fairly new, see? And every one of these things has made me appreciate the scriptures even more. Because now I'm learning to read them for what they were intended to say, not for what I was told they were meant to say. See what I'm saying? Do you see what I'm saying? All right. All right. Anyway, and then I said to you last week that secondly, this verse 27, the New King James, and a lot of the modern versions, go all evangelical on us when it says here that to whom the Son wills to reveal him, as though the Son wills to reveal him to some, but not to others.
Yeah.
But that's why I said you can't separate it from verse 28 or 29 and 30, really, but you can't separate it from verse 28. You have to keep it together, because if you think about this, you know, the idea is not what he wills, that he wills or chooses some over others. You got to keep in mind here what it is he wills to reveal to you, right? And what has he been talking about giving to all who come to him? Well, an eternity in heaven. No. That's not what he's talking about. He just said, no one knows the Father except the Son, see, and the one to whom he will, not he wills, but he will reveal him, right? All right, now I know we can say, well, it still sounds like he's willing. No, that's not what I said. He will. I will do something for you. Okay, when I say I will do something for you, I mean, I'm not saying I'm willing to do this for you. I'm saying I will do this for you, right? Okay, so there's a slight difference in the way we use that word there. And so what's he talking about giving to all who will come to him? The revelation of the Father. The reality, see? The reality of the Father. Think who we're talking, I mean, think who this is talking, right? So in other words, to a polytheistic, badly mistaken culture into which he enters, including not the Jews only, but everybody around him, all right? He says, no one knows the Father, but I will reveal him to all who will observe and follow me. He didn't say everybody that will come down to the pulpit and pray the sinner's prayer will have a revelation of the Father. How could you, in the midst of this culture that we have cultivated in the Christian church for so many generations now, how could you have a revelation of the Father? We were watching a rather enjoyable movie the other night. I won't tell you the name of the movie. It was a cute movie, and it was a true story of somebody that's well known. And, you know, they lost a child in childbirth. And immediately, you know, talking about this individual began to hate God because the baby died. You know, and it was all about what God did to take the baby's life and how God needed another little angel in heaven and all that BS that we've all heard at some point or another, right?
Right.
See, and again, I enjoyed the movie, but the thing is, just because you come to something, pray some prayer, wherever it is, does not mean you have a revelation of the Father. It means you are acknowledging Jesus. I'm not debating that. I'm not trying to take anything away from you in terms of your security in the Father's love. I'm not trying to do any of that at all. I just want you to realize that what he said here was, if you come unto me, if you will observe and follow me. That's what he means by come unto me. Observe and follow me. Come along with me. Right? What did he say to the brothers that he found mending their nets in Matthew 5:17? Come, follow me. That's what he meant by come unto me. He always meant come, follow me. What does following him mean? It means to observe him, to replicate him, to do what he does, to think the way, see what I'm saying? And so he said, if you come and watch me, basically. But if you're not willing to do that, he said, I'm not turning my back on you, but you just need to understand that you're probably going to continue on in the same corrupt revelation of Papa that you've had. See? Okay. See, if we've come to Jesus for something other than a revelation and an introduction to the Father, we've really missed the point.
Yeah, that's right.
Not that there isn't so much more in Jesus, but it all begins with a revelation of the Father. See what I'm saying? I'm not taking away anything of what Jesus has so wonderfully given us in his self-sacrifice. But what I do want us to realize is that if we've come to him for anything other than primarily the revelation and introduction to the Father, we've missed the point. And the truth is that we'll continue to be seduced by Israel's Old Testament character sketches of Father until we realize that only Jesus is the truth of how God is structured, of how God is ordered, and how God orders and arranges himself towards humanity. Okay? Now, as we said last week, you know, we've seen that we have Jeremiah's, you know, indictment regarding corrupt prophetic communication, you know, in the conversation of Israel and Judah. Specifically, we were dealing with Judah in the book of Lamentations there, but we have Jeremiah's indictment of that, right? And then also we have what we've read today, you know, this pointed inquisition of Isaiah that is directing Israel's attention to their polytheistic likening, comparing, and determining equal God to the likes of, for instance, in chapter 46, Bel and Nebo. Isaiah 46:1, see that it started with their involvement with Bel and Nebo, Babylonian gods. Right? And then, of course, we have Paul's Romans 1 dissertation, right, of corrupt identities of God in Old Testament humanity. And then, but with all of this, we have no more reliable word concerning corrupt communications about the Father than the voice of Jesus. You understand that? See, I can take you to where Jeremiah says your prophets have no vision and they envision for you delusion, deception, and confusion, and so on. I can take you to that. I can take you to Romans 1, and I can show you in Romans 1, as we've done, that Paul said that the revelation of God in the Old Testament was corrupt. I can take you to those places. I can take you back here, and I can suggest from Isaiah that Isaiah is saying, to whom then will you liken God? Because they were likening God to Bel and Nebo in that particular case. See? I can take you there, but you still have the right, the privilege of discounting that if you'd like. And most people have. But we have no more reliable word than Jesus, John 1:18, John 6:46, Matthew 11:27. See? We have no more reliable word than Jesus. For regarding faulty character sketches of God. Isn't that right? Now we know this, you don't need to turn there. We talked about it last week, Matthew 16:13. Jesus first said, who do men say that I am? Who do the men of your culture, who do the men that you interact with, who do the faith preachers and the grace preachers and the, you know, and the evangelicals and the fundamentalists and the charismatics and the Catholics, who do they say that I am? See? Not that there's nothing valid in anything that they might say, but who do they say that I am? And then they gave their answer, of course. And he says, but who do you say that I am? Who do you say that I am, right? And as I said to you last week, that sounds an awful lot like Isaiah 40:18, verse 25 and 46:5, doesn't it? Who do you say that I am, right? So, and my belief is that Jesus was purposely directing these Jewish disciples to these passages from Isaiah, which I believe Isaiah was probably the most well-known of the books, of the scrolls that probably most of Israel was exposed to, even those who hadn't been through rabbinical school and stuff. But I'll bet you that who do you say that I am? Who do you say that I am? Who do you say that I am? You see, I'll bet you that he was intending to direct their attention to the whom, to introduce them to the whom that God was in fact to be likened to, compared to, and determined equal, himself. You see that? I believe that's what he was doing. Okay. Now John says this about the Logos, about the structuring reality, right? It says the Logos was the true light which gives light. What does it give? Light. What is light in the Bible? Revelation. It's also life, but it's revelation. The light which gives light to, now listen to me. Some folks who study the Bible and go to theological seminaries, no, says to every man coming into the world. Yep. The Logos In other words, there's but one place to look, see, for the structuring reality, for the true revelation of God, and that is Jesus. Isn't that right? All right. Matthew included this, these words from Isaiah, but Matthew brought them into the present experience. He said, the people who sat in darkness, futile thoughts and darkened hearts, the people who sat in darkness have seen a great light, have perceived a great light, right? So in other words, only Jesus is the remedy for futile thoughts and darkened hearts concerning the reality of the Father's person. But it's not something we come by just by saying, I've acknowledged Jesus as my Lord and Savior, or I went and accepted Jesus. It's something that when we come to Him, when we follow Him, when we observe Him, His life, it's something that He reveals to us in His very being, in His very doing. It's not that He sits us down. He may tell us some things too once in a while like that. But it's not that He sits us down and says, let me show you the Father by giving you Scripture. He said, let me show you the Father by follow me. Watch what I do. Do what I do. Talk like I talk. Reject the things that I reject. Accept the things that I accept the people that I accept. Right? All right. Let's conclude with Hebrews chapter 1, because I'm going to go there to start next week. Like I said, we're going to wrap Jesus around this week anyway, because this is just where we showed up. Thank God. Hebrews chapter 1, verse 1. God, who at various times and in various ways spoke in time past to the fathers by the prophets. I like that, because verse 1 verifies here right away that He certainly did get through to the prophets from time to time. In other words, this verifies what I said. These were godly men. These were men that really did care about purity in their message and stuff. But anyway, it says He did that. But He has in these last days spoken to us by, the word by here is that Greek word en that occurs like 170 times, I mean, it translated by, but it occurs like 1952 times translated in, in. And several of the translations I looked up say in. And I think that in is better than by again. He has spoken to us in His Son. Yeah. Yeah. You could almost say from within His Son. He has revealed Himself from within His Son. Not just spoken to us by His Son telling us what He's like, right? But His Son, if you've seen me, you've seen the Father, right? I and the Father are one, right? So, in is better than by. Not that by doesn't work. By works if we understand what it means. It means in. So you might as well have in, right? He has spoken to us but in His Son, whom He appointed heir of all things, through whom He made the worlds. I want you to keep that in mind, because that's going to be important when we go back to Isaiah next week. To whom do we liken God? The fact that He is heir of all things through whom He made the world, right? So He spoke to us in His Son, verse 3, who being the brightness of His glory and the express image of His person, or New American Standard, the exact representation of His nature, right? Okay. And so, distorted character sketches, divine personality disorders, corrupt portraits of God, now listen to me carefully, are to be cheerfully, not fearfully, cheerfully discarded. I want to say that again. All these distorted images of God, we are not to fear casting them aside. No matter what we're told by some theologian somewhere, or some well-meaning pastor, or some well-meaning mother or father, right? We are to cheerfully cast aside these distorted character sketches of our God. Why? Because a definitive structure of the reality of God has appeared, setting a match to the polytheistic photos of human composition. The Logos became flesh. Did you get anything out of that?